Good evening, everybody. Please be seated. Did he say good morning? Good evening, right? Oh, sorry. Good afternoon. I don't know why sometimes I'm just ahead of time. I'm sorry for that. I hope you have been much blessed by this conference these past 2 days. Have you? And I'm sure you do with all these the wonderful men of God that God has brought in your midst, and you are hearing end time words that God would speak for this nation and for this city and for the churches in this region. Like I mentioned earlier, I mean yesterday, that God sends prophets to a nation or a church not to condemn the nation or to condemn the church, but to show His yardstick, and then to measure ourselves against the yardstick so that we will know whether we are walking right or not before God. And when we are not walking right before God, we want to measure ourselves to that yardstick. So that's the whole purpose of God sending a prophet to a nation or to a church, to redeem the nation or the church back to Himself. So whatever judgments or whatever corrections that are pronounced, those are not punitive towards destruction, but towards redemption, to and back to restoration. Amen. And during this conference, you've been this past whole of yesterday, you've been hearing about our television network called Angel TV, and I'm sure many of you are watching it, and perhaps many of you are not watching it and you do not know how to watch it. All these wonderful men of God that you hear in our conference here, they are also speaking on a weekly basis, sometimes once or twice a week on our television network. So when you come to this conference, and after tomorrow is not the end of hearing wonderful, meaty word of God, but you can continue to hear them. And of course, with today, with the modern technology of YouTube, you can access any stuffs on YouTube, all the messages. But remember, there's always the good, the bad, and the ugly, and the rotten on the YouTube. You know, sometimes we are just like little babies who starts crawling. All those of your parents who know, once the baby start crawling, the first thing they do is, whatever they can put their hand out to, they'll put everything into their mouth. Am I right? They do not know how to differentiate the good, the bad, the ugly, and the rotten. Everything goes into the mouth. Even a pin goes into the mouth, and eventually you have to bring them to emergency. I have seen many, many families destroyed because they heard wrong stuffs on the internet or on the YouTube. Just to quote one good example, there was one wonderful family in our dear Pastor Jose's church, wonderful family with greatly blessed talents, and they were like pillars in the church. And they started watching some teachings from America on YouTube, and their minds got turned to a different direction. And Pastor Jose and his dear wife comes to our youth camp meeting that we conduct annually in India, northern part of India. So in one particular year, this family, several members of the family, also came to the camp meeting. And at the end of the camp meeting, as we were riding down, driving down from the Himalayan mountains right to the foothills where there is an airport, this brother sat beside me and he said, "I wanted to ask you some questions." So I said, "I'll be glad to answer your questions if I knew the answers." And then he quoted this particular preacher and this particular teaching that he heard on YouTube. And he asked me, "What is your opinion?" So I said, "Instead of asking for my opinion, you should ask your pastor for the opinion." That is the proper way, no? You go and consult your church pastor, not a visiting speaker. So he said, before I could consult my church pastor, I went to ask for your opinion. So I heard everything that he had to say, and I told him, my dear brother, what you heard, that teaching is not biblical, and it's not practical, it is not spiritual, don't buy or eat that garbage. That's my counsel to him. But he wouldn't listen. You know, like what we shared earlier, you like to hear, have your ears tickled. This is another signs of the last days. You know, we like to have our ears tickled, and just like what Dr. Bruce Allen read about a prophecy written by a woman from which nation? Norway. And she must be a prophetess in order to have such encounters with God. And whatever we see today in our present day, not even society, but also in the church society at large, all the grisly gospel, cheap grace teachings. I was actually shocked to hear in exact detail how God had revealed to this woman 30 years ago before it all happened. And they were all in exact detail. So the teachings that are so popular and prevalent today, where a large majority of people are flocking to such churches, God has revealed 30 years ago that that is a perversion that is coming into the church. And the perversion today is widely embraced as a wonderful thing. And there's a church in Singapore, the largest church, which embraces such teaching. Now, once you embrace such teaching, you always will have a large crowd. Even if all the seven churches in our committee here, if they were to embrace that teaching, this conference we will be holding in the Sydney Olympic Stadium. Right? We would not be in this place, because we'll have a great crowd who will want to have their ears itched. Now, this is a sad picture that we want to be careful of. So, that family wouldn't listen to correction. Eventually, they created a big ruckus in the church, and not only that family left, but they pulled several others also out of the church, about maybe 15, 20 of them out. See, once you claim to have special light and others are not agreeing with you, you will end up starting your own church. Because if you cannot submit under somebody, you will eventually become the boss. Right? You have to become the boss. So you will have to have a company of people who will want to believe that particular teaching. You know, such things will never ever stand. Because anything that is built on unrighteousness will never stand. It will fall. About 20 years ago, I was invited to minister at a pastor's fellowship in Singapore. And after the fellowship, the pastors always have their special fellowship, teas, cakes, all the stuffs, you know. What good is a fellowship without eating, right? Even our pastor Limbu announced earlier, we have spiritual fellowship and then we have physical fellowship. So after this conference, don't immediately rush to eating, because we need to bend our knees and pray. Amen. And so while we were eating, a young pastor came up to me and he gave me his name card and he introduced himself and said, next time when you visit Singapore, please come to our church. So as a mark of courtesy, I said, all right, I will consider it. So when I went back, I began to pray about the invitation, and the Lord told me, don't go, period. And I don't know why the Lord said don't go, and neither is it my habit to ask the Lord, why don't go? Because if the master says don't go, you period, you know, don't go. If you keep on asking, you'll end up becoming like Balaam. I'm sure you don't want to become like Balaam. Once a no is a no, or a yes is a yes, you don't ask any further. And subsequently, another time at the same fellowship, this pastor came up to me again, and he said, when are you going to come to our church? And he extended another invitation, and before he left, he shook my hand. As soon as his hand touched my hand, I heard the Lord say, don't go to his church. So I didn't know why the Lord would tell me not to go to his church the second time. So I went and prayed and asked the Lord, why are you not allowing me to go to this church? And the Lord told me, I don't want you to go to his church because that church is built on unrighteousness. The foundation of the church is unrighteousness, and that is blood in his hands. So don't go. So I didn't know anything further about the church. So I called my host pastor who invited me to the fellowship. I said, can you tell me something about this pastor and his church? And he told me a very heartbreaking, pathetic story. This young man was a youth pastor of another church, a larger church. And the larger church, the pastor, he labored to build his church from zero. So he slaughtered, he shed tears, he fasted, he prayed, he plowed the land, and they had evangelistic meetings, and they grew the church from zero to about 150 over a little time. And this church also does missions work to the Philippines. So once the pastor, the senior pastor, led a team to go to the Philippines for a missions work. In his absence, you know, this is what most churches do. Instead of assigning their own elders or their own youth pastors to preach, they will open the pulpit for other guest speakers who are visiting guest speakers from around the world to come and speak in their churches. Sometimes good comes, sometimes bad, sometimes ugly, sometimes rotten comes. And so an American speaker, an American minister came to speak in their church the very first Sunday that the pastor had gone. He preached a good message that was edifying the church. After his ministry, he started ministering to the people. And then he pointed his finger straight at this youth pastor and he said, my dear brother, God has called you to do great work, and this place is not your place. You're supposed to go out and start your own church, and you will have a great ministry, blah, 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 blah. So, and that young pastor was so excited with that prophetic word. Before the senior pastor could come back, he took all the youths out of the church and started his own church. Not only the youths, when the youths go, the parents go along. Right? That's quite biblical, you know. You see, in Matthew chapter 21, when the Lord Jesus told the disciples to go and get the donkey, not only the donkey came, but the foal of the donkey also came along. So children go, parents go. Quite biblical. Amen? So, and a large chunk of the church left the church. And after 2 weeks, when the senior pastor came back from Philippines, he saw his church dwindle down to a small number. He was shocked and surprised what happened. And eventually, he heard from the elder the whole story of what happened. He was so heartbroken. He fell down on his face and he cried bitterly unto God. Broken-hearted man. And this is what the Lord showed me. He stole. You know, if I believe with all my heart, God can call someone out of a church to do something greater. I have no doubt about that. But that should not be at the expense of breaking your own church. If God calls you out, you should go out as a single person. Go out. and pioneer a work from scratch, launch out into the deep and fish, not fish in the same pond. Christians are very good at fishing in a pond rather than launching out into the deep. You know, once I was standing at a bus stop many years ago, and there was some youths who were distributing flyers for their church meeting. So this one young boy came up to me and he said, "Uncle, please take this track, this flyer for our meeting." So when he looked at my clothes, he must have thought I was a Hindu priest. So he was so happy, a prospect of getting a Hindu priest converted. So I played along that game. You know, why spoil the fun, right? So I just played along the game and I asked him a few questions about who is this Jesus? How do you know that Jesus is the true God? So I just played along the game, you know. And that young man was very fiery. He tried his best to give all the right answers. But I made sure that I stirred up his faith to cause him to doubt his own faith. You know? And but that young man tried his very best to answer all my questions. So finally I told him, "Look, I am a believer myself." He said, "It's all right, uncle. You can still come to a church and repent and get saved again." So I told him, "You know, why are you doing this? You should go out to the Hindus, the Muslims, the Buddhist people, all the other non-Christians, and give this one invitation to them, not come to the Christian and make them leave their own church and come to your church. That is wrong." This is what we largely do, isn't it? Fishing in the same pond. That is very, very wrong. When you do that, you are building your church on unrighteousness. And when you build on unrighteousness, it will never, never stand. And God will not be in it. He's never in it. He's far away. He's outside. So let's bear this in mind. That is why God sends prophets to give us corrections towards redemption, corrections towards restoration, so that we will know the walk that we need to walk, so that our churches will be built on righteousness, like the bride of Christ, not like building a building, a church, after the pastor's own image and likeness. As we are built in Christ's own image and likeness, we should build the believers after the image and likeness of Christ and build the kingdom of God rather than building our own kingdom. Amen. So that's why this kind of conferences are organized, to blow the trumpet, to calling back to our first love. That is the primary duty of a prophet, calling the church back to its first love. And that is the very first message the Lord Jesus gave to the seven churches. The first church, Ephesian church, say, "Come back to your first love." And then the last church, the Laodicean church, is also a call to come back to the first place of being the sons and daughters of God. So that's why we are here. And so many such teachings you find on Angel TV. And many of you, I believe you're watching online through the internet, but you can also watch Angel TV through satellite. Of course, it's not available on your cable yet, Foxtel or Optus, whatever cable you have. But maybe in the days to come, we will get them on the cable. But it's very, very expensive to go on cable. They charge us a hefty sum of money that we need to pay them every month for them to carry us on the cable. But if you have an Optus satellite dish, you can very easily watch not only Angel TV but many, many Christian channels. If you don't want all the other filth and garbage that comes through your cable, but you only want Christian channels, we have a booth outside. What is it called, Pastor Rocco? Afri. Afri? P-R. Afri. Afri? Afri. Okay. Afri. Afri, our dear brother Afri is out there with a booth. He is a fixer of dishes. So you can hire him. He can come and fix a dish on your rooftop so that you can watch Angel TV on your big 55 or 75 or 85 television screen. You don't have 85? Oh, how poor thing. In India, we have 110 inches. See how advanced we are. Not only 110 inches, we have now 4K television screens, which is 140 inch. See, that is real life watching. Not only that, we also telecast a monthly prophetic conferences that we do live from our television studio in India. Every third Sunday of the month, we do an evangelistic prophetic conference. And on the last Saturday of the month, we have a healing service. And then on the last Sunday of the month, we have a prophetic conference. So those are all televised live, besides many other live programs that are televised live on all our 12 channels. I will share more about this to you tomorrow, as well explain to you about Angel TV. And besides that, we also have a very special program for youths called the Spirit, Ultimate Spirit Warrior. Did you chance by the table outside where there's Ultimate Spirit Warrior? Where is Pex? Pexy? Up there, can you come down? Pexy, the man that you saw playing on the drum, is the beloved son-in-law of Pastor Jose and Pastor Stella Rocco. Only son-in-law and favorite son-in-law. When you have one, he's the favorite, right? And a few years ago, we were doing filming a program for children in Paxi's house. And while we were filming, and Paxi was helping us with the cameras, and I was standing in one corner watching the whole, directing the whole program, and I saw an angel of the Lord come and stand beside him. And the angel said to me, he has a special call on his life for youth, and to do and create youth programs for these last days. So then I called him aside after the filming, and I spoke to him at length. I said, you know, this is what I saw, and God has a special call upon your life. Why don't you spend some time fasting and praying and ask God what he wants you to do concerning this? And can we have a mic, please? And as he fasted and he prayed, God gave him this wonderful idea about a program that is quite similar to what you would see on a commercial station called The Survivor. Have you seen those programs? We didn't exactly model it after that because we don't offer any prize money. You know, those survivors, they have to eat cockroaches, rats, iguana, Komodo dragon, all kinds of stuff. Here we don't do all that, but we model. God gave him ideas to model games tailored for youths that will teach them survival in the end times. He will explain to you in greater detail.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello, everyone. My name's Pax. Yes, it's true. We were sitting in my lounge room, and he said, what's on your mind? I said, there's just nothing for the youth that really will prepare them. He goes, as he does. Pray about it, my son. Fast. So I did, and God gave me this blueprint. So I started writing everything down. He was giving me a lot of dreams and a lot of visions about what he wants and how he wants it to run and what it's actually for. The end blueprint, only he knows. The blueprint for now is preparation. As they have all been talking about, it's preparation. Preparing yourselves for the end times. The youth love to go to meetings and muck around and play and worship. But when it comes time to the word, it's get the phone out. This excites them. This gets them doing stuff. It gets them fit, but it gets them thinking. What would happen if I got put into a situation where 5 men in tactical gear with AR-15s run through that door and hold me up with a gun to my head and say, denounce Jesus? What would you do? Well, we're going to find out. Because this is the kind of tactical thinking we need to think about in the end times. This is the blueprint he's given. We don't just do that kind of stuff. That's an extreme level that future shows are going to be showing. We do simple stuff like carry your cross. Pick up your cross daily. It's in Luke. We had them pick up a 50 kilo cross and carry it until they dropped. Half of them cried like babies, which was a good thing because it touched them. It showed them what the smallest bit that Jesus did for them and how hard it was. They only lasted 5 or 6 minutes at a time. He had to carry it all the way to his death. And they saw that. And this is what he's trying to do. He's trying to teach them and show them that this is real. The end time, the last days is coming. They need to be prepared. They're his warriors. They're his army. So the youth in India are more than happy to cop what I give them. It's more than just games. It's an actual boot camp. I run them through drills in the morning. I really tire them out. I fast them for the whole day. And then we do a part of the show. And then we talk about stuff at night. We have Bible readings around a campfire. And then 9 o'clock, bedtime. Then I get them up at 5 o'clock the next morning. And they go through the whole thing again.
So what is your purpose for sharing all this to all these people in Australia?
Well, he gave it to me as a...
Do you want them to participate in your games?
Of course.
Tell that.
That's it's a kingdom national thing that he wants it to happen. He wants it in all the nations. He wants it in Australia. We've started in India. He wants it in America. He wants it every nation. He wants the youth to be built up and prepared for the last days.
So now we have done how many seasons?
We've done 2 seasons so far.
Okay.
And we've already planned for 3 and 4 next year.
So you are inviting all these people to come and participate in the games?
No, they'll be coming to 5. Season 5. Hopefully season 5 will be in Australia. There's a few issues in Australia.
So is this for only the young people or even elderly people can join in?
Well, as we were talking about, we've got one for the G7 that we're going to do.
We
have to organize the lions. Lion? Real lion? Okay. And the furnaces. We have to get the furnaces as well.
You know,
that's another thing.
As Brother Pax is mentioning this. I always share this heart-wrenching incident that took place sometime early last year or the year before in Syria. This is a Christian family, a father, mother, and two girls. The two girls are 8-year-old and 6-year-old. One day the mother was praying and she heard the Lord say, "Will you lay yourselves on the altar for me?" And she understood that the altar meant to offer herself as a martyr. And she, without any hesitation, she knelt down, she lifted up her hands, and she said, "Yes, Lord, I offer myself as a martyr." 2 days later, as she was praying, she heard the voice of the Lord say, "Will you offer your husband as a martyr for me?" She hesitated a little bit, and then she stopped praying. She went and discussed with her husband. As soon as he heard that, he said, "Honey, let's kneel down," and they both hold hands, and they offered themselves on the altar. 3 or 4 days later, she heard the Lord say, "Will you offer your two darling babies on the altar for me?" Now, this was really too much for the woman. She stopped praying and she pondered over this for a couple of days. And then one morning she called her two girls, made them sit on her lap, and she told her this. She said, "One of these days, some bad guys with hood on their face, with swords and rifles in their hands, will come into our house. And if you, when you see them putting a sword on daddy's throat, close your eyes real tight. Don't see them. No matter what happens, no matter what you hear, don't open your eyes. Until when you feel something sharp on your throat, then open your eyes, look at those hooded men and tell them, 'I forgive you for killing my parents and Jesus loves you.'" This is what the mother told those two girls. And the two girls understood perfectly what the mother told them. So all the four knelt down, they held their hands, and they prayed, committing themselves on the altar for the Lord. And after all this was done, a few days later, one morning, their living room door was kicked, banged open, and 3 ISIS terrorists walked in. And they killed the father, and he dropped dead because he was asked to renounce the Lord and accept Muhammad as the only prophet of Islam. He refused to do, and they beheaded him. And the children heard that, and they remembered what the mother said. The older girl held the hand of the younger girl real tight and told her, "Close your eyes." And they closed their eyes real tight. And then they heard the next sound of a body falling on the ground. That was the mother. She fell down, and a pool of blood began to flow all over the house. The next minute, those two girls felt something sharp on their necks. And they remembered what the mother said. They opened their eyes and they saw 3 hooded guys with an ISIS banner on their forehead standing before them. And the guys asked them, "Will you renounce Jesus Christ as Lord and God and accept Islam as your true, or Allah as your true God?" The girls looked at the guy and she said, "I forgive you for killing our parents and Jesus loves you." With that, the sword went through the necks of the two girls. They fell down dead. Now, this is a true incident that took place in Syria. And the Bible tells us in the coming days, more Christians will die as martyrs. Now, the games that PAX is developing is kind of a dry run to such real scenario. So what will we do when our faith is put on the blocks? What will we do? It's very easy to say right now, "Oh, no matter what happens, I will stand faithful for the Lord." It's easy right now because you are not in a situation. What if a gun is put on your temple? Then what? Then what will we really do? Or Pastor Andy's handsome little boy by the mother's side, a kukri, the Nepali sword, is put on his neck. Or worse still, those guys strangle the little boy snack, what will the mother do? Will she praise the Lord? Hallelujah, praise the Lord. My son is going to die as a martyr. Will the mother do that? I bet no. She will be screaming and crying, and the terrorists will be choking little by little the very life out of the boy, forcing the mother and the father to renounce their faith. They do all this in communist countries. So what are we going to do? So these games, they are not real games, although it appears like games, but they are practicals, like a dry runs, making us to look at our own heart. So if you like to participate in these games, please go to the booth outside, Ultimate Spirit Warrior, and they'll give you any free gifts for them.
There was,
until
as soon as everyone heard free.
Oh.
Unfortunately, there's no more left, but we will get some more for you.
Okay. Yeah. You know, Bax and his wife Maris, who was leading us in the worship, they approached some corporate companies about this project. The corporate companies sponsored this wristband, this t-shirt, and this cap and the pant.
No.
Not the pant. Okay, that's yours.
That's me.
And they were very kind to sponsor all that. So if you want more information about the Ultimate Spirit Warrior game, please go to the booth and look for Mr. Pax.
I'll be hiding
Thank
upstairs.
You. Give a good clap to Pax.
Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Let's stand up for a word of prayer. Our gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we come before your holy presence. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ this afternoon. Open our hearts. Open our ears. That we may hear what the Spirit of the Lord is speaking to the churches. And is speaking to this nation in these last days. Give us an understanding heart. And give us a listening ear that we may hear what the Lord is speaking to us and the direction which He is showing to us. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray, Amen. Please be seated. Since the whole of yesterday, I do not know what was preached this morning, but yesterday you heard about myself and the other two speakers bringing words of judgment. And you will know that when I ministered in the morning, the other two speakers were not there. But when they brought the messages, it all lined up. Like part one, part two, part three, like confirming one another. Am I right, everybody? It was like confirming and reconfirming what was spoken in the first message. And the one word that you keep on hearing continuously was of the judgment. And yes, last night, as I was after we went back to our hotel rooms, and as I was waiting, I had a visitation from an angel of God who told me to wait at God at 10 a.m. the following morning. So, and God would want to speak. So this morning at 10 a.m., I waited before God at the appointed time. And as I waited, I was caught up to heaven to participate at a council of prophets in heaven. You know, in heaven there are many, many councils. And among the one council, there is a council of the prophets. And this prophets' council chiefly is concerned or it oversees the last day's events that are going to take place on this earth. There are many, many gatherings in heaven. You know, the one thing that we are all most familiar with is a worship service in heaven. Most of us are only familiar with that because that's what we chiefly read in the book of Revelation, that everybody gather and they are worshiping God. So somehow we all have a wrong notion that in heaven everybody worships 24/7, which is not true, because there is worship that goes on in heaven continuously, and that is done by the angels. Certain classes of angels are created for that purpose, and they are in one secluded one part of heaven. You know, the Bible says, in my Father's house are many mansions, with a plural, right? And the Greek word for mansions is actually not mentions. The word mentions is not correct. It should be, Greek word is mone, M-O-N-E, and mone means realms, realms of existence. So it's not a mansion like we would think, a huge castle like Buckingham Palace. No, that's not the right translation. It is plains or places of existence. Like for example, you have Castle Hill, you have Campbelltown, you have Chatswood, you have this, you have Liverpool, Blackpool. You have Blackpool? No, Blackpool, sorry. You know, Liverpool is a city in England, and there's also another city in England called Blackpool. So if you have Liverpool, I thought that you must have Blackpool. No, Blackpool, all right. So like that, you know, suburbs where people live. Likewise, in heaven, there are these realms of existence or living. Or to make you feel a little comfortable, like, let's call it suburbs. There are different suburbs. And in one such realm is where a class of angels specially created to worship God and fill the whole of heaven with praise. And their job or their created purpose is to continuously lift up praise all throughout. For lack of a better word, let's use the word day. Because in heaven there is no day, no night. So it's one complete eternity. So their job, or job again is not the right word, created purpose is to worship and praise God all continually. Now that is one place. But there is a time in heaven where all beings, created beings in heaven, together with all the redeemed saints, they all gather together to worship God. Like, for example, on your Sunday church service. 6 days of a week, you go to work. Then on a Sunday, you gather, everybody gather to worship God. This you read in Job chapter 1 and Job chapter 2, where the Bible says, there was a day when the sons of God all gathered before God. So that is called a general worship. And in Revelation, you read about that continually in chapter 7, where all the angels and all the redeemed saints, together with the 24 elders, they all worshiped God. So there is a special time where a worship, general worship service takes place in heaven. But besides all this, there are so many other activities that take place in heaven. If you read the book of Revelation very carefully, you will find a lot of activities that keeps on going in one place of heaven. If you read chapter 8, you will find the angels bringing bowls of prayer before God. So if they are worshipping God all 24/7, so where do they have time to bring bowls of prayer? And then in chapter 5, you'll read the 24 elders received the bowls of prayer and they offered before God. So if the 24 elders are also engaged in worshipping all 24 hours, so where do they find the time to receive these bowls of prayer to offer unto God? And then you'll read in Revelation chapter 12 that the angels, Michael and his angels, are engaged in war. If Michael and his angels are also involved in worship all 24 hours, where are they going to find time to go and fight war? So there are so many activities take place all